Hello, this is Dr. Tami DenOtter. Welcome back to your MSK day of your radiology rotation. Hopefully you all had time to watch my first mini lecture on fractures, mimics of fractures, and fracture healing. Today I will be discussing common fractures of the upper extremity with special attention to scaphoid fractures and the workup of scaphoid fractures and complications of scaphoid fractures. Let's get started. This is a PA radiograph of the left hand in a patient with snuff box tenderness. What do you see? Great. Hopefully you appreciate that this field of view is too large to evaluate the scaphoid. This radiograph includes the entire hand, wrist, and portions of the distal forearm. We really need dedicated radiographic series of the scaphoid, which consists of PA, oblique, lateral, and PA with ulnar deviation view, otherwise known as the scaphoid view. Our next radiograph here is a scaphoid view radiograph of the left wrist and hand. Hopefully you again appreciate that this field of view is still too large. This is inadequate to evaluate for scaphoid pathology. Speaking of scaphoid pathology, let's talk a little bit about the mechanism of injury. Usually the mechanism of injury for scaphoid fractures is a fall on an outstretched hand. This is due to forced dorsiflexion and radial deviation that maximizes the force across the scaphoid. Also, it is important to note that the blood supply to the scaphoid is unusual in that the arterial supply enters distally. This in turn makes the proximal pull of the scaphoid completely dependent on interosseous blood supply, which sometimes can lead to prolonged healing and possible osteonecrosis. These are very important things to note and why it is important to properly image the scaphoid and not miss a scaphoid fracture. Now we have an appropriate scaphoid view radiograph of the wrist in a skeletally immature. This is a much better field of view. This is a navicular view, or also known as a scaphoid view, with ulnar deviation of the wrist on a PA radiograph. This is in a 13-year-old boy who just injured his wrist playing football. Here you can see there is an acute scaphoid fracture. As we discussed previously, we can see in my prior mini lecture, we can see cortical discontinuity, and we also see a somewhat subtle linear lucency within the mid portion of the scaphoid. This is an acute scaphoid fracture. Now, our next radiograph here with the right white arrow depicts another patient that has snuff box tenderness. This patient right here had clinical concern for an acute scaphoid fracture. On radiographic imaging, we do see some mild cortical irregularity. This was read as indeterminate for possible scaphoid fracture, and a follow-up radiograph was obtained, which is the radiograph here on the right that contains the blue arrow, the white open arrow, and the red line. Here we can see on a 10-day follow-up radiograph that we see some lucency within the trabecula, which is demonstrated right next to the red squiggly line. We also now see a focal area of cortical disruption. So looking back here on the initial radiograph, this was essentially an occult fracture, and on our follow-up radiograph obtained 10 days later, the fracture becomes more visible. Hopefully you all recall from my first mini lecture that the first stage of healing is fracture resorption, and we can see occult fractures better at between days 10 and 14. Just as a friendly reminder, please do not follow up imaging prior to 10 to 14 days, as it could lead to, again, an occult fracture being not being visualized. So we need to do proper follow-up imaging when there's clinical concern for an occult fracture, which is at days 10 to 14. Next, here is another radiograph, PA radiograph of the wrist in a different patient. Again, this patient has clinical concern. There's clinical concern for scaphoid fracture. What do we see? Well, on this radiograph, you do see a linear line through the scaphoid, but that is not a fracture. We need to remember that we have a current 2D radiograph of the wrist, and the scaphoid is obviously a three-dimensional bone, and there are normal ridges within the scaphoid. So this is a normal radiograph of the scaphoid. I will tell you, however, that there was high clinical suspicion for a scaphoid fracture in this patient. So what should the ordering clinician do? Well, like we just previously discussed, that we could obtain follow-up radiographs in days 10 to 14. But this patient was a rugby player that did not want to be immobilized for 14 days. So the ordering physician went on to order an MRI, which is the appropriate imaging test if you do not want to immobilize the possible fracture and follow up in 10 to 14 days. So here is a coronal T1 image of their wrist, where we now see there is an acute scaphoid fracture. We can see a linear aerosclerosis within the scaphoid, as well as some low T1 signal within the scaphoid, which is some bone marrow edema. Let's pause for a second and let's talk about the types of scaphoid fractures. This is the most common type of scaphoid fracture, which is a fracture through the waist of the scaphoid. This is the most common scaphoid fracture and can go on to non-union and malunion. And again, this is due to the unique blood supply to the scaphoid, which enters distally. There's a distal pole of the scaphoid fracture, which usually heals without complication. And we also can have a proximal pole scaphoid fracture, which is the least common type of fracture, but it is the most problematic, again, secondary to its unique blood supply. Here is a coronal proton density image of the same patient that we just saw the coronal T1 image of, and it again depicts the acute fracture through the scaphoid. So hopefully you appreciate this, the fracture that was occult on that initial radiograph, and we see some high signal distally, which is some bone marrow edema. Okay, now let's review scaphoid fractures. Usually they clinically present with a snuff box tenderness. It's usually due to a fall on an outstretched hand, and radiographs are the imaging modality that we should first use. And we need to include ulnar deviation view if we really have clinical suspicion for a scaphoid fracture. And like we've discussed previously, we need a proper field of view. If there's a question of clinically occult fracture, we can either immobilize and follow up in 10 to 14 days, or you can go on to MR imaging if there's high clinical suspicion and immobilization is not an option. Here now is a coronal CT of the wrist. CT is the imaging modality of choice to evaluate the healing of fractures. Here we see a partially healed fracture with partial bone bridging of the proximal pole and distal aspect of the scaphoid. Remember from our previous lecture, we talked about primary healing, which is bridging through the trabecula and bridging of the bone, or we have secondary healing, which is your periosteal bone callus formation, which we do not see here because this is an intra-articular fracture. So this fracture heals by primary healing. Approximately 90% of scaphoid fractures heal without complication. Distal scaphoid fractures are usually immobilized 6 to 8 weeks. Scaphoid waist fractures are usually immobilized for healing 8 to 12 weeks. And proximal scaphoid fractures need to be immobilized anywhere between 12 to 24 weeks. Again, this is due to the unique blood supply to the scaphoid. Now let's talk a little bit about non-healing of fractures. Remember, not all fractures heal. What is this called? Non-union. Non-union is lack of osseous bridging of the fracture gap in an expected time frame. Now that's very important to note when we say it's an expected time frame. So most of the time that is a clinical diagnosis as they know when the date of injury occurred. Usually in my reports, I just talk about if there's bone bridging or not, and I do not use the words non-union as I let the clinician determine if it's been in the appropriate amount of time from the date of injury. Now there can be hypertrophic non-union, which is abundant peripheral callus, which is again signs of secondary healing, or we can have atrophic non-union when no callus develops. In this AP radiograph of the wrist, we see atrophic non-union of the scaphoid. We see sclerotic margins, and we see no evidence of bone bridging. Also note that there is a fracture at the base of the fifth metacarpal. Please always remember that when you identify one fracture on a radiograph, you should keep looking at all the other bones to make sure there's not a secondary fracture. Now, complications of scaphoid fractures include non-union, as we just discussed, which usually is a failure to heal after 6 months. You can also have delayed union, which is incomplete union after 4 months, or scaphoid fractures can go on to osteonecrosis. This occurs in approximately 20% of scaphoid fractures. Here is a radiograph of the wrist, which demonstrates a mild sclerosis of the proximal pole of the scaphoid. When fractures are healing, you can get some mild sclerosis, so we do not want to overcall osteonecrosis. If, however, there is high clinical suspicion for osteonecrosis, we can go on to MR imaging. Here is a coronal MR image of the wrist, which shows some sclerosis of the proximal pole of the scaphoid. This would be very suspicious for a possible avascular necrosis of the proximal pole of the scaphoid. So hopefully you have enjoyed your lecture today on acute fractures of the upper extremity with talk about the scaphoid fractures and workup of occult scaphoid fractures and any complications of the scaphoid fractures. Thank you.